Alan wrote this intro here. It's your basic, welcome to Completionist. We don't dispute the games, we complete them. And then we're on to Faces of Evil.
Yep.
Which is one of those really bad, that's like a CDi one, right? The bad CDi Zelda game?
Yep.
It's like the one of Gamelon. It's got the weird cutscenes. Yep. And the, sounds pretty rough.
Yep.
What do you want to give it a, what's the rating you want to give it? A donate it or?
Yep.
Yes!
All glory goes to the winner! Game over! Wake up! Last one standing wins! K.O.!
The Legend of Zelda. It's a series I've praised ad nauseum. Name a title. Go ahead, name one. Yeah, I've completed it. Name another one. Yeah, done that one too. Go ahead, give me one more. Are you kidding me? I know that one like the back of my hand. I've interviewed Zelda creator Shigeru Miyamoto. Reggie knows me as the guy in the tingle outfit. And if your doctor tells you your Zelda count is low today, call me up for a transfusion because that stuff is coursing through my veins. So, how did Link, Faces of Evil, elude me all of my life? Well, for starters, it has eluded most of the world. Chances are you've never even heard of this game until now, or you saw your favorite content creator meme on it many years ago. And on the slight chance that you have heard of it, well, you're probably strapping yourself in for the onslaught of cringe heading your way right now. And the reason why Faces of Evil eluded most of the world is because it was released in the early 90s on the short-lived Philips CDi, a console marketed mainly as an educational tool that boasted CD-quality sound and an excessive price. I won't go too much into detail on its history since I did that 4 years ago with my Zelda The One of Gamelon episode. All you'd really need to know is that the CDi as a console failed, and the games that Nintendo licensed out its characters for are not good. Since neither I nor anyone else of sound in mind owned a CDi, I unfortunately had to play it on emulators. Both the platform and this game are collector's items at this point. And for anyone out there who's curious about actual Nintendo games disappearing from the public view, you can check out one of our eShop videos. I say actual Nintendo games because Nintendo had virtually no involvement in the development of these three titles that were licensed out for Zelda characters on the Philips CDi. They can't really be considered Zelda games. They're not even viewed as canon. So why, after completing Wand of Gamelon all these years ago, are we doing this again? Well, mostly because Tears of the Kingdom is almost done. I promise, video's coming very soon. And second, I'm such a big Zelda fan, I not only want to celebrate the successes, I also want to understand the weird stumbles. And to separate myself from the slew and slog of other reviews that trash this little game that couldn't, I'm gonna try something a bit different. In the hands of a different developer, Faces of Evil had the monumental task of living up to the success of Link to the Past, and every game since has made this stepsister of a game look uglier and uglier by comparison. It doesn't seem fair. I'm not gonna do what I did with the Wand of Gamelon. I'm gonna do my best to remove all the comparison to the quote-unquote proper Zelda games and see if there's any semblance of a swan with this weird duckling. I want to see the good in it, okay? Great. So, here we go.
Stir the berries in the tub. Let the juices soak the glove. Let Link fight and never cower. For his glove's a glove of power.
Wow, thanks.
No, I can do this. I can do this. I can do this. Come on. Come on, I can do this. I can do this. I'm not scared of Zelda. Come on, I'm not scared of Link. I got this. This is easy. I've been doing this for 12 years. I can go all day. I can go all the time.
Look at Link go. He's sure doing it. He's off to save Princess Zelda from the clutches of the evil Ganon. To do so, he'll first need to defeat Ganon's allies and once again bring peace to the land of Koridai. But he can't do it alone. He'll need the help of some classic Zelda friends, such as King Harkinian.
My boy, this peace is what all true warriors strive for.
Morshu the Merchant.
Sorry, Link.
I can't give credit. Come back when you're a little, richer.
Wizard on carpet.
Your Majesty, Ganon and his minions have seized the island of Koridai.
Drunk guy.
Don't fight him, feed him.
Book wizard.
I am the reader, Ipo.
Her.
You're not afraid of dragons, are you?
Ice wizard.
Now, if we make a simple vacuum and spin the ice just so, there.
Ice witch?
Before you face the foul fiend, Ganon.
Iced witch?
Help! Ganon froze the fountain. I'm stuck.
These fairies?
You're doing great, Link.
And so many others. We really get to know and love these characters in the brief, purely transactional interactions we get with them. Hey, Link, give me the thing, and I'll give you a thing. Thanks. Person inexplicably in the middle of this level, I'll cherish this moment always. To add to the cut and dry nature Faces of Evil has to offer, there's nothing to do outside the scope of beating the game for completion. No optional side quests, no bonus heart pieces, no missable gear or upgrades, just some no-frills, straightforward early 90s gameplay. As Bill Clinton would famously say, just beat the game, loser. Even with a single simple playthrough, we learn to love these scamps. What about Link himself? Oh, don't you worry, he's the spunky, talkative, shitty kid we always wanted him to be. He's finally a product of the early 90s, an era when it was decreed that every child must be kind of an asshole. And they kind of talk like this. Wow, the world is ending. Guess I'll do a kickflip. Who needs a Link of silent introspection when we get...
Gee, it sure is boring around here.
Cool. He's a cool Link.
Hey everyone, our longtime partner of the show, Helix Sleep, is back at it again, supporting you and providing you with some premium mattresses customized to fit your needs. These are all mattresses that are conveniently shipped to your door and are easy to set up. And that's all I needed to hear. You can head on over to helixsleep.com/completionist and get 20% off your Helix mattress. Plus you get 2 free pillows, but I've got more to say. I'm contractually obligated to do so, but I do it with a smile. I've had my Helix Sleep mattress for over 2 years now, and Fraser, who's the one helping me do all this right now, is our general manager, and he has had his mattress for quite some time, and we're getting the best sleep of our lives. You can take the Helix Sleep quiz right now to find the perfect mattress that fits your needs, no matter what your body type or preferences are. And Helix Sleep offers a 100-night sleep trial, as well as a 10-year warranty. That's on top of providing financial options and flexible payment plans. And worry not, because these mattresses are fiberglass free, contain no eldritch curses, and won't snitch on you if you're sharing your login for your streaming services. So, go to helixsleep.com/completionist today, save some cash, and sleep easy. Thanks for sponsoring us. Now back to the show.
You didn't think I was going to show you all these awesome clips from the game and not talk about them, did ya? Faces of Evil deviates from simply having sprites do all of the heavy lifting by bringing these characters to life with the best animation outsourcing to Russia that can be provided. Never mind that much older games have had way better animation, that's part of the charm, probably. I enjoy how their movement doesn't seem to reflect what they're saying, and are instead super generic. Kind of like the animation team didn't have a script to go off of and were told just to make each character move around and it will look fine in the end. Well, mission accomplished, no notes. That's just the animated cutscenes. The in-game aesthetics provide a nice little change. A bit of spice, if you will. You know how in most 2D platformers where it's way too obvious to tell what is something you can jump on and what is part of the background? Well, Faces of Evil will have you constantly guessing. Keeps you on your toes. Don't try jumping on this thing sticking out of the wall. That's the wrong thing sticking out of the wall. That's the damn background. You're much better jumping on this thing sticking out of the wall. How can you tell the difference? You just gotta feel it out, man. You can't just play Faces of Evil. You have to feel it. This area looks safe and nice. Some fairies gave me life and there's a serene pool. Let's just jump over here and see for, oh no, that's death. That peaceful spot is death, good to know. I'm sure this was intentional. This was a learning process meant to mirror the lesson Link learns as he follows the hero's journey. I'm learning. Just like it seems the animators were left to their own devices, so was the composer. Good. Who needs to get bogged down in communication when you can just let your composer pretend like he's writing for that 90s action film that he never got to work on? Let me be clear here. This music, however, does slap. It is rad. If you're wondering if I'm being sarcastic or grasping at straws here, I am not. The overworld map music is reminiscent of Bowser's theme from Mario 64, and this game came out years before. Seriously, tack these tracks onto Streets of Rage or any Van Damme movie, and it would be right at home. It's just not at all what I imagine when I think of my favorite green-clad hero on his fantastical adventure to defeat Ganon. Composers Tony Trippi and William Havelick definitely zigged when all other Zelda music previously zagged. But who's to say what a Zelda game should sound like at this point, right? Change is important for any franchise. Let's look to Breath of the Wild with its minimalistic score after the wide-sweeping orchestral medleys of Skyward Sword. If you ask me, it was about time that the Zelda series got that Escape from New York vibe it was missing, and both Wand of Gamelon and Faces of Evil rock in that regard. So now that we've established that this game is flawless in terms of its overall presentation, there's gotta be an issue somewhere, right? The gameplay, perhaps? Oh, no, still perfect. This is some Castlevania-level combat right here, folks. Just more streamlined. Instead of having a few creatures spawn from different points, spawn 80 from the exact same point. My impulse is to keep exploring and progress through the level. But the game really makes you slow down and appreciate where you are at in your life. If 80 repeat fish don't do this for you, 80 repeat pterodactyls are bound to get your blood pumping. What's fun about these jabronis is that they don't attack you at the ground level, they don't attack you at jump height level, but this sweet little purgatory in between, just right there. In other games, a quick tap of the jump button would give you a baby jump where you could easily attack an enemy at various heights. Oh, not here. It's all or nothing, causing you to time your jumps preemptively or just flail your sword about and wish for the best. Maybe you'll hit it, maybe you won't. Who's to say? That's just Faces of Evil, man. Speaking of maybe or maybe not getting hit, it's not always clear when Link takes damage. You'll walk up to an enemy, swing your sword, and then they're down. Cool. Do it again to this other fool. Same outcome, except this time you've lost half a heart. Interesting. Was there an animation of the enemy attacking? Hard to tell. Was there an animation of Link getting bumped back from his injury? Oh, absolutely not. Does Link turn translucent for a second, signifying a moment of invincibility or that you've taken damage? No, and nope, and what invincibility? That's right, Link could be standing under deadly, falling icicles, and you won't know until you ask yourself, what's that generic sound effect I hear? And then you notice your hearts are depleting at rapid speed, and then you realize that you apparently are dying, and then you have to move somewhere else. The developer's intention here is clear. They don't want you to think about injury or death. They want you to think about your life. Why dwell on invincibility frames and clearly conveying when Link is in danger? We're here to focus on living, man, even if it means dying more easily. Oh, okay, now let's talk about my favorite mechanic in the game, using special items and going through doors. To move through doors, you press button 2. Now remember, this is Philips CDi speak. Think of it as the B button on every other controller on every other console ever made. To open your inventory, you hold down on the directional pad and also press button 2. Once you have your special item selected, press your old friend button 2 in order to use it. Here's where it gets fun. Upon entering certain areas, you're immediately faced with an onslaught of enemies. Sometimes they're a specific enemy that's immune to sword damage. For example, ice dudes only are hurt by fireballs, and fire dudes are only hurt by snowballs. You don't have time to think, just open up your inventory and choose what you need to give him hell. Oops, I was in a doorway when I tried to open my inventory. Sorry, the game prioritized the doorway, so I ended up leaving the area instead. You got me there, Faces of Evil. It's no matter. I'll choose the special item I need out here, then go back to this other area and give him hell. Oh, right. Using the special item is also button 2. Got me again, Faces of Evil. So in order to use the item I need, I have to first walk out of the doorway, leaving myself open to any danger, and then give him hell. I made this mistake many, many times. That's on me. And what a wild ride it was, this journey between Gerard and button 2. Oh, don't you worry though, button 1 had its time to shine. It's what you press to make Link attack with his sword. You also get an NPC to talk to by hitting them with your sword. Notice I didn't say button 1 makes you attack, and it also allows you to interact with NPCs. No, the game literally tells you to hit people with your sword to make them talk. Instead of just removing the attack animation for when you speak within the distance of an ally, the game justifies hitting them with your sword because it's a smart sword. It's fine, everyone. My sword won't hurt you. It's smart. It's a smart sword, guys.
Luckily, I brought my smart sword. It won't hurt anyone friendly. In fact, it makes them talk.
I believe the developer's intention is clear here as well. They were going for realism. Hitting someone with a sword in order to make them talk mimics real life. I mean, it's the best way to get anyone to say something. Observe.
Observe what?
See?
But for those instances where an NPC is surrounded by enemies, fighting for your life can lead to an unplanned conversation. Button 1 teaches you that talking to your friends takes priority to fighting your enemies. And that's pretty deep. You know, something about The Legend of Zelda, Link, Faces of Evil reminds me of is the Soulsborne games. Need I say more? I do. Okay. One of the Soulsborne trademarks is that they don't hold your hand by making it clear where you're supposed to go next. This game managed to somehow do the same thing, but years earlier and without the help of online communities from other players. You were really on your own here, just like in the good old NES Zelda days. Your starting map has a number of locations to choose from. You don't know what's a choosable location until you chaotically move your cursor somewhere and the name of a location pops up on screen. I chose Goronyu because A, Goronyu sounds like Goron, and that makes me think of other games that I totally wouldn't be rather be playing right now, and we're not gonna talk about it, and B, that's the closest place to where the cursor was to begin with. Long story short, this whole area turned out to merely be a place to farm rupees. Sorry, rubies. So you can buy some gear from the merchant. Getting through levels would often lead to opening up new ones. No ceremony or pizzazz when that happens. You know how in Mario World you beat a level and then you're taken back to the overworld map and then a little like animation happens that clearly shows that you've opened up a new area, you've discovered, or a secret or something like that? Not here. You get through Nortinka, boom, world map. Toy-Q Lighthouse, cursor's already there. No time for celebration. You're left wondering, did I even beat the previous level? It doesn't matter. Nothing matters anymore. Again, I think I can safely speak for the developers here. The developer's intention is clear. In life, there is no time for celebration. No time to rest on your laurels. Push onward into the dark night, my friend. Do not look back. And the fun keeps on going, folks. Remember when I said that the interactions with NPCs are merely transactional? Many times, the items you receive, you have no clue what their use is for. That, or you get bodied by a boss, only to discover that you don't have the item needed to defeat them. I fought Lupe and, after getting wrecked, took the coward's way out and immediately checked for a strategy. I regret doing this because I'd rather beat my head against a wall and fight the boss 20 more times for no reason. It turns out you can't beat Lupe unless you have the reflecting shield to return those green snakes that are apparently laser beams. And the clue to knowing this is nowhere. Nowhere at all. It just really pushes you to think. I still have no idea what the hell this bell does. I got it. No one told me what to do with it. I rang it. Nothing happened except that was 5 rupees. God damn it. 5 rubies, poorer. I'm not going to keep ringing it and keep losing money. That's weird. I figured there would be a great boss or blocked passage somewhere in my journey that would require this bell. Nope. I beat the game and then totally forgot I had the bell on me until now. Well, I'm curious. What was the bell for? Okay, let's see here. In the Faces of Evil, the bell is an item that can be rung to stop flying enemies for a short period of time for about 8 seconds. You know, that might have actually been really useful. It's just too bad I never used it. With this discovery in mind, the developers' intentions are clear. They want you to question everything. They want you to doubt if everything in a game must indeed have a use. Could a pipe just be a pipe? Could a bell just be a bell? They then want you to defeat your flying enemies all on your own so you can look back and say, I didn't need that very useful bell. The strength was within you all along, Scarecrow. I can honestly say, Link, Faces of Evil, crushes any concept of what a game could or should be. Everything you know to be true is a fiction. Everything you know to be impossible is within reach. Follow your dreams and something, something, just as the developers intended.
Wow, 7.5 hours just flew by. It would have been closer to like 5 to maybe like 5.5, but you know, I had to use an emulator because I couldn't really find a working and functional Philips CDi, let alone a copy of the game that wasn't too expensive. So, you know, I guess the positive side of things is that...
Gerard, you okay, bud?
Huh?
You can just tell us how you feel.
It's Zelda.
Yeah, I know. You want to be nice Zelda. To it because you like Zelda, but like you've said it yourself, it's not Zelda. So if you just give us a rating.
Donate it.
Okay.
Donate it, but also keep it because it's probably expensive, but for this video, donate it. Don't give it to a little kid.
You feel better?
No.